All right. Okay, can we take a breath together? This has been one hell in heaven of the last 7 days. Exactly right about now, I was fighting a fire naked.
Naked?
Yes, naked.
The only way to do it.
You know.
It's the only way. You want to burn up your clothes.
Oh, I know. This was one of the deepest lessons I've ever experienced.
Wow.
You know, I know that it may seem humorous at some levels, but it's not humorous when you're in the middle of something like that. You know?
No way.
And I don't mind you laughing. Yeah, well, as a matter of fact, I think it's very necessary. So that's a good thing to do. There's been so many transformations in my consciousness since then that I'm a combination of totally 100% exhausted and 100% grateful and stunned. And this is like the first time that I've had a chance in the sense to just sit down and kind of begin to integrate it. Next tomorrow, I'll be the first time I can kind of sit, like have a minute to myself, because the last week has been an unbelievable experience. You know, right before class, Anna and I had just got through studying a part of the Course in Miracles that was talking about your ego wants to kill you because you dare to believe you're innocent. It says that is to your ego, that is the biggest sin of all, is for us to actually consider the fact that we may be totally innocent and totally sinless and totally guiltless. He says, we are always trying to feel guilty about, how did he put it in the course, what he calls a weird assortment of ego ideals, whether you dressed too short, or you looked at somebody you shouldn't have, or you made some money, you know, all this stuff in the world that we come up with that we feel, because the course says it's just nothing but ego stuff. It's like it has absolutely no reason to feel guilty about the stuff that most people are feeling guilty about. But he says the thing that really gets to the ego is when you start to believe that you're the holy child of God, and you really start to believe that you're innocent, and you really start to believe you're sinless, and you really start to take responsibility for your experience, and you stop rejecting, and you stop blaming, and you really want to experience your experience from a level of love and a level of awareness far beyond anything you've ever experienced before. And that's what has been happening, what I've been experiencing in the last 2 or 3 months. It's like it's been like an exponential kind of awakening. And it all started with that whole idea of getting really once and for all letting go of my grievances for real. And the Course in Miracles says that a grievance is not what we think a grievance is. A grievance is every time you say, if this were different, I'd be happy. If somebody else spoke or behaved different, I'd be happy. If I was in another place, if I was in another circumstance, then I'd be happy. You know, so he says that the grievance is always coming in with everything that's supposed to change other than yourself. Everybody who's supposed to change rather than yourself. And the other part of that, he says, was the idea of recognizing that your salvation comes from you, which is the same as saying your happiness comes from you. So the truth is, I really got at a soul level, at a gut level, that no one else was going to ever make me happy. That was the most fallacious idea that most people walk around with. Is they're going to meet the person who's going to make them happy, or they're going to get the job that's going to make them happy, or they're going to get the money that's going to make them happy. And those things are neutral. All of those things are completely neutral. But I give myself happiness about my financial situation, or sadness about my financial situation, or I give myself happiness about my relationships, or sadness about my relationship. I'm the one that's in any relationship that I've ever been in, and you too, every feeling that you had, you thought came from somebody else, didn't come from anybody else. All those feelings came from you. And there was something about that person that triggered you to have those feelings. And so he says, what we do is then we turn around And then we say that person made me feel good, or that person is the one I need to be with in order to be happy. But what really happened was you gave yourself that joy and your happiness. So I had made the decision that since my happiness comes from me and it doesn't come from anywhere else, that I was going to catch myself every time I told myself, or if I felt that if something were different, I'd be happy. If somebody acted differently, I'd be happy. So now, anytime I feel any kind of lack of peace, then I immediately go, okay, you're saying if this were different, then you'd be happy. That's where you're unhappy right now. Mm-hmm. It's something about this. You're saying something's wrong with this present moment. You're saying that God and love and truth is not in this moment. And not only are you saying it's not in this moment, you're saying that it's outside of you in this moment. And so I had really stopped focusing on the idea of anybody around me needed to be anything other than who they are in order for me to be happy. And it was creating a level of innocence and a level of joy and a level of peace that was beyond anything I'd ever known before. Because I felt free. That's the best way I could describe it. I really feel free. It's almost like if you really, 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 really get that you, like I've said before, like you can't start your car with a vacuum cleaner, and you've been trying to start your car with a vacuum cleaner and haven't successfully started your car. And he says that's the way it is with us, with this whole idea of everybody else were different or behave different or acted out our script, then we'd be happy. That's the exact same thing. And it never works. And we know it never works. It's never worked with anybody. Mm-hmm. You've never met a person in your life that's ever given you happiness all the time according to the script that you've set for you. None of us have. But the ego always says, well, the next person, this is going to be the one. So I felt free because I really had accepted the truth that there was nobody else that was going to do that, and nobody else was making me feel anything other than what I was feeling. So the minute that I realized that, my grievances toward everybody dropped. Whether it was my, everybody, I just felt it go poof, because they never did anything to me, because they never could have made me happy anyway. So it was no reason to be upset with them about what they didn't do, right? So I'm feeling more innocent. And then being a fanatic studying the Course in Miracles and Way of Mastery and all of that, because that's my greatest joy. My greatest joy is communing with Spirit. And so what happened was there was more love coming to me than I'd ever experienced. So that's what was so funny. It was like the minute I let go, then I started to experience more love than I've ever experienced before coming through everybody, no matter where I was, which is kind of freaky, you know. So I was accepting my innocence, accepting my sinlessness. And so I was reading this section. So Anna and I was reading this section, and I was saying to her, I said, you know, I have this real ominous feeling. Mm-hmm. I said that at the very beginning of the conversation. I said, I have this real ominous feeling. And then we read that about, you know, that your ego wants to kill you. Like the Course says, death comes from your ego. It comes from the part of you that believes you're a body and believes that you are a body that dies. The death doesn't come from God. It comes from our beliefs about ourselves. And so we project it onto God, but it's not really God, according to the Course, and also the Way of Mastery. And so we got through reading, and it was very powerful. We was like in an altered state. And so I got ready to prepare to come to class. I was really looking forward to coming to class. Mm-hmm. I had heard from some people before class. It was some people coming from out of town.
Yeah.
One lady who'd been watching me for 3 years, she really wanted to meet me, and I was looking forward to her coming. Anyway, it was really interesting. I'm getting ready to go to go take a shower, and this voice said very clear to me, listen. And I listened, and I heard a crackling sound that sound like a campfire. And because my blinds were closed, and then I looked around and saw that my balcony was in flames.
Oh my God!
And so it's really kind of hilarious, even though it was terrifying. So I'm looking at I got to get this fire out. Was the first thing that hit me. So I'm getting ready to get in the shower. So I'm out there on the balcony, trying to fight the fire, completely buck naked. trying to fight the fire.
Wow.
And then all of a sudden, the guy came downstairs, and he handed me a fire extinguisher, and he left.
he was gone.
So I'm trying to, but before he brought that down, I was like, God, I got to get this out. It was windy. It was really windy last Tuesday. So the flames were really coming up, and so I ran to the refrigerator, and all I had was there was a big jug of milk. It was organic, so that helped. And so I ran out and I tried to douse it with that. That didn't work because it went down and then it got lodged. So I ran back to the refrigerator.
Wow.
And I got some aloe gel. I had a big thing of aloe gel. Then I tried to use that and it didn't work. Then I had the fire extinguisher. And I thought I had it almost out. By then, all hell was breaking loose in the building. You know, the alarm was going off. People were being rushing out. I'm hearing fire trucks, and all kinds of stuff was going on.
Wow!
And I ended up to the fire. So like, it must have been 20 firemen. It must have been. It was 8 fire trucks. They blocked off both sides of Colorado. Yeah. They had the bucket truck. Then they came into the apartment with a hose. Got me out of the apartment. All I have on is a robe and no glasses, no cell phone, no shoes. So I'm downstairs, all the people coming out of the building. And that's why I wasn't able to let anybody know what was going on.
Right.
But everybody was sold, all the firemen, the arson investigator came and he was like, you can sit in our truck. And everybody was so loving and was so friendly. And I had kind of an attitude toward this new resident manager, and she wasn't acting out my script in terms of, you know, some people, you meet them, they're part of you, but for some reason you make yourself not like them, and you really don't have, you really don't know why. It's not really like they've done something, but for some reason you just, I had that experience of her, that for some reason that I would choose to feel separate from her and her energy. And I was packing up some stuff to put in the storage, so that's why there were some boxes on the back. And then what happened was somebody flicked a cigarette from above me, because I saw, it's fun, right before I came over, I saw the cigarette. It was interesting. So anyway, so all of this is going on, and if you can imagine how surreal that must have seemed to me. I mean, just picture that. Colorado Boulevard, blocked both sides, at least four or five fire trucks, 15 firemen, people in the building, and it's your apartment. It's not like it's somebody else's apartment. That's your apartment that you're looking at. And they, you know, and so anyway, they got it out, but they did damage and a lot of stuff. So the resident agent came up, and I thought that it's like I was getting ready to have an attitude, but I was watching my ego, and then the voice inside of me said so clearly, if she were different, you'd be happy. And you know, now I have a standard response to the Holy Spirit when He says stuff like that to me when I'm in situations, and it's pretty profane. it's very irreverent. We got this ongoing joke that's been going on for 25 years or so. And the Holy Spirit catches me in my stuff, and I say, "F you," and then the Holy Spirit laughs. Right? And so we had this ongoing thing, right? And so now when it's a let it go, and I realized again. If this were different, I'd be happy. And even in a situation like that, if this were different, I'd be happy, right? Mm-hmm. So, so it was such a trip how everybody was. So it's at one point then the resident manager said, "Well, you know, I need to, you know, talk to you tomorrow or whatever, you know, because it started and it was some boxes on my balcony, and that's what it called." And so, okay, so it's going to be some thing about the boxes being on the balcony that I needed to, you know, that I needed to put in the storage, but shouldn't have been there because then if it hadn't been there, then it couldn't have caught fire.
Oh.
Right. So anyway, but then I did the forgiveness thing. And just like, said, oh, okay, you know, I need to let it go. Mm-hmm. And so as soon as I said that, then she came back to the door and she looked, she said, well, you can't stay in this apartment. And so she immediately took me to another apartment that she said I could stay in. It was a really nice apartment. And she was making herself very available and very helpful in ways that I didn't even expect her to, the ones I changed my mind. Mm-hmm. As soon mm-hmm. as I changed my mind, then I had a new experience mm-hmm. of her. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting because the Course in Miracles conference, the theme of it was, you know, change your mind and change the world. Mm. You know, that was the whole theme of the conference. And so I changed my mind, and then she immediately changed, and then she gave me a place, and then that I could spend the night, and I got a lot of wonderful offers that people were sending me. You know, Zen came over, and she was going to make sure I was okay, and offered her place, and it was, and then before I even came downstairs, the Red Cross was there. And the Red Cross was there. I was like, what is it here? The Red Cross is here. I was like, what? The Red Cross. And they come up there and they talking to me and they wanted to make sure I'm okay. And they were so loving and they were so helpful. And they gave me a debit card for $125.
Before and no pants?
Even with no pants on. You know what I'm saying?
You know, and no pants?
You know, yeah, it's like I'm telling you. The ego tried to kill me, and then the Holy Spirit was coming at me with so much love and support from so many different directions, people calling me, you know, it was amazing to have mm-hmm. the kind of experience
Absolutely.
That I had, you know, and so it so happened the next day, she was saying, well, you know, you can't stay in the apartment anymore, there's water damage, mold, all kind of stuff can happen, so she took me to an apartment that was larger than the one that I was in, and said, you can stay here in this apartment. I said, okay, when y'all get through fixing mine up, then I'll just move back into mine, right? And then she said, no, you can stay in this apartment now. And said, well, how much rent do you pay? I told her what I paid. I was in a studio, this was one bedroom. And she went, okay, just keep paying what you're paying. Ended up getting a better apartment that was larger at the same price mm-hmm. in Denver. And the Denver rental rates right now are just ridiculous.
Right.
It's, mm-hmm. you know, depending on how your paper strip situation is.
Yeah.
So that was like Tuesday evening. So I had to move everything from my that was left from my apartment to the other apartment Wednesday. Wow. And then I had to leave Thursday to go to the conference.
Wow.
So in 24 hours, I've lived in that apartment 14 years.
Well, the others got some stuff.
So it was like, so I'm like, but then the Holy Spirit, but the apartment that I was given was right down the hall. I was in 804. Yeah. The new apartment is 809. Mm-hmm. So the Holy Spirit blessed me with not having to deal with elevators, moving stuff up and down. I'm just watching Spirit just take over in this situation. As long as I kept saying, it's not about it, this one different. I'd be happy. I just saw the grace of God. I saw what the Course says, because he says, your ego might try to do you in, but I will take care of your body and your ego. Mm. And so the promise is, if you really, really want to go for your sinlessness and your guiltlessness, even though the part of you that thinks you are not that way might try to create situations that literally take you out, the part of you that's love, that's God, that's Spirit, will protect you. And that's what I saw. I saw the protection of God, because I played it back in my mind and I was visualizing when I was fighting that fire and what a sight that must have looked like. And the wind could have blown in any direction.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I'm totally untouched.
Right.
Oh, yeah, here was the other part of it. Had I not heard the crackling noise,
I had
gone into the shower.
You wouldn't have
The way my apartment is situated, and it was just about to go into the main area of the apartment, then I would have been trapped.
Oh.
I wouldn't have been able to get out. because the fire would have been between me and the door. And so I saw that too, had I not listened. Or I was going to come here earlier to set up, mm-hmm. and I didn't. So because if I had not been there, then the fire could have affected many more people other than me, because it would have been out of control, because I happened to know. So I was watching Spirit all the way around take care of me. And then when I went to the conference, I said, well, this must be a really deep conference for all of this to be going on. And I experienced so much love and great energy that it was like all my brothers and sisters, and including you all's energy, was like enveloped me. I felt like I was being totally enveloped by the love of God. I was being totally, so if I seem kind of off, it's because I'm in awe. I mean, I'm right now, and I'm tired as I don't know what, you know, but it's just, I'm just amazed at how true the Course in Miracles is. I'm amazed at how true the Way of Mastery is, and why people will not take the time to focus into this stuff to the point that they will allow themselves to have that kind of connection at a conscious level to Source. It's just always amazing to me. Because what we come up with to try to make ourselves happy is so pitiful. And it never really works. You know what I'm talking about? It's like you would think that something that doesn't work that often, we would like not continue to try to do it over and over again. And then we'll tell ourselves this stuff is the hard stuff. And then what the world is teaching us is the thing that we should focus on that's more important. So there was one miracle after another miracle after another miracle. Mm-hmm. And Vegas was so over the top. Mm-hmm. That's one thing I love about Vegas. It's like, if you want to see the illusion at its most pristine level, I mean, those casinos and stuff, I'm like, you know, I love the Venetian, you know, they got gondolas, you know, like you in Italy. And they have, it was so funny because a lot of them have fake skies, you know, inside of the hotel. So you're looking up and it looks just like a real sky. It's really awesome. I mean, but what's a trip about the illusion of it is, it's like you're in an illusion in an illusion. Yeah. It's like you look like it's a sky, but you're actually in a building.
Yeah.
And it doesn't look like a building to you at all. And that's what the Course keeps telling us about this. The exact same thing, that we're completely deluded about where we are.
Wow.
And it's like being in Vegas and me being inside the Venetian, which was a replica of Italy, but me actually thinking I was in Italy because it looked like Italy, and it was, you know, and that's what the Course is telling us. We are totally fooled by the illusion, and we totally think it's real, but it's not. And we have a reality beyond this. This is an illusion inside of an illusion too.
Oh my God.
So, and then of course, the night that I'm, you know, running around naked fighting fires would be the night that, you know, so many people came to the class. I mean, like it's just a ridiculous amount of people that wanted to come, you know, because they knew I wasn't gonna be here. I can say I wanted to hear the truth, but you know, it really didn't.
I really didn't
want to, but I can say I came tonight, you know. And you would be amazed at also the effect that these glasses and looking through the eyes of love were having on people everywhere, not just the people in the conference, everywhere. Mm-hmm. I'd never seen people so loving and friendly. But they were, it's just, we are onto something. This is true.
Mm-hmm.
Commit yourself. Know that there's a part of you that's going to try to prove to you that none of it's true. Let go of that belief that your happiness is out. So, because sometimes when people hear your happiness comes from you, it depresses them because they think they've done such a lousy job at being able to make themselves happy. That's why they're looking for somebody else to do it. So when you say stuff to people like your happiness comes from you, it tends not to excite them because they believe they've done such a poor job at making themselves happy. So when you say that, it's like, oh my God, I haven't been able to ever make my... But the truth is you've never really looked at it like your happiness really does not come from anybody else. It might be intellectually something that we say, but very seldom do I ever meet anybody that lives their life as if their happiness does not come from outside themselves. Because you could talk to the average person on the street and you say, you know, your happiness comes from within. They'll say, yes, it does. Happiness comes from within. And the next second, they'll be mad about something that they wish were different. And I saw that split mind that we have that can say the truth in a hot second, but does not apply to the physical reality that we're in. It's like this neat division between, boy, I believe I'm sustained by the love of God, and God, I'm worried about how I'm going to pay my bills next month. And we don't see that's a total disconnect from what you just said. Or, God really loves me and love is my natural state. Oh, how can I meet somebody that really loves me and really fulfills me? And it's we don't realize that's a total disconnect between from the truth when we say that, because this is going to reflect the attitude I have toward myself. And so when it says your happiness comes from you, it's not talking about your ego trying to make up something else that makes you happy. It's talking about getting out of the way so that the happiness that you are in your natural state from God, from the divine, can come through you and allow you to experience happiness. So happiness isn't really something that we can make for ourselves, because we didn't create ourselves. And that's the other thing. You know, I didn't create myself, so I really can't create my happiness. That which created me knows what will make me happy. So I'm trying to make that switch, that 100% responsibility switch, and I really want to join with other people that want to do that. And this thing's come up that from that night. So I'm really, like I said, my life changed 180 degrees in the last week. I mean, in a big, 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 big way. And so I'm curious to see, because I still feel like, I don't feel like that was the end. I feel like that was the beginning of it. Because everything has been, the intensity of each day since then has just stepped up more and more and more and more. So that wasn't like, oh, that was the completion. No, it started with the 8-alarm fire. And I'm a fire sign, and fire is purification. And fire is, and also I had to get, it's like I had possessions that were ruined, things I had to throw away, let go of. So I had to go through this big purging process. But there was a part of me, I swear, that has been completely calm throughout the whole, that was calm even in the middle of the fire. It was a part of me that was witnessing it from a very calm, dispassionate place. And then it was another part of me worried about my jewels being burned. So it's and you probably had that experience too, where you was watching, what you call it, like watching yourself go off or watching yourself be angry, but it's another part of you that's just observing it. But I feel like I've been born again in a lot of ways. And so I'm curious to see who comes and what comes out of me, because what came out of me doing the two talks that I did in Las Vegas, I've never had people respond and say the things to me that they said to me after that, because it was unbelievable. It was unbelievable. So I just want to be a better conduit. I'm back, and I want to be more of a conduit for love. But every time I change consciousness, people change. So in a way, I'm not surprised at who's here tonight at all, you know, because I'm not in the same room that I was in the last time, and you are not the same people I was with last time. It looks like you are, but you're not. It looks like I'm in the same church, but I'm not. It's all illusion. We're in another dimension. We're in another reality. And you are going through similar changes, or you wouldn't be sitting in front of me.
Right,
you know what I'm saying? That's why this group of people that showed up tonight is because my story is your story. I bet you have your own inner transformations and realizations that are going on that even the people around you who know you, they don't have any idea, because they're looking at your body, so they still think it's the same person behind those eyes, and it's not. And don't you think for a second it's the same Raj in front of you that you saw 2 weeks ago, because it's not, you know. This one is saner. He's much saner. Yeah. So it's funny that tonight, any thoughts? Anybody want any feedback about anything I've said?
Thank you for sharing that.
Well, I was going back and forth about whether or not to go into the details of it, or even to record it, but then I realized that, you know, that's the whole point of the thing. really. It was a lesson.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so it should be shared. But I'm going to tell you, it was, you know, you talk about you're not a body, and you talk about, you know, death being an illusion. But when you're in a situation like that, and you can see how that possibility is looking at you right in the face, it's very interesting to... It makes the things that you make yourself upset about seem so petty. It really does. It's like the stuff that you hear people talking about, they're upset about, and they, and you see that in most cases, just like the book says, they're just making themselves upset. Yeah. And I'm just making myself up. Really don't have no problem at all, but my ego don't think I deserve that kind of peace, so I make up stuff to be upset about. And so that's how most people entertain themselves. They entertain themselves through coming up with things that they think they're upset about, because that gives them some level of feeling.
Totally.
Yeah, because most people don't feel nothing. So they feel, drama or anger, at least that's a feeling. You know, and with men especially, anger is usually the way men express fear. Because it's not really, you know, it's not really cool for a guy to be like. So men, when they're afraid, they just used to come out of an aggressive place. But it's still the same thing. It's just fear. So I love you. I appreciate you. And I'm excited about the adventures that we're about to have. But you better believe it. This the 2016. Yeah. 2016 has its vibe to it. Yeah. Now, am I by myself? Anybody else?
Oh, yes, outside.
Okay, I mean, are you feeling something going on within yourself?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would just like to share that I feel really grateful that your ego didn't kill you. And that I got to experience this other level of love for you. Like, it just, I didn't know what happened, and so, but I just got to focus on how appreciative I am for you, and how fortunate I feel that I get to interact with you, and that you are such an influential and incredible teacher to me, and so I just feel so, so happy with you to see this transformation, and that your ego didn't kill you, because I like you in this body too, and beyond.
Thank you so much. Yes. Thank you for saying that. Yeah.
It was amazing, Earl, too, how we really depended on you. I just really depend on you. And when you weren't here, it was really interesting that when I was watching the crowd, you know, and how we were feeling, you know, it was really curious.
I know.
Just to be on the porch, you know, hearing what's going on. This has never happened, and how come? And, you know, it was really interesting.
And then I know clearly there is a probable reality. There is another dream where I never made it out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because all possibilities exist on all these multidimensional levels. So I know that there's another situation that it didn't go that way. But that was the one the ego did get.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? This is the one the ego didn't get that time. But then this is the one that the ego will never get.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who we really are, the ego will never get. Mm-hmm. But who we are not, it'll get all the time.
Yeah.
You know, that the false self is the one that's vulnerable, not the real one. So when we come together and we join like this, we have no idea the level of protective, loving energy that we give to each other that's far beyond what it looks like. Mm-hmm. You know, because I felt you. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt you. And then also show how much I enjoyed being with you, because I felt very disappointed that I didn't get a chance to join. You know. And it made me not which is interesting, because my family doesn't know anything about it. I haven't had the conversation with any of them about it. That was the other thing too, because unless I tell them, they'll never know.
Right.
Yeah.
That's
weird.
Exactly.
That's right. And they never know. Yeah. If I didn't say anything, because we don't have the kind of communication that's a day-to-day communication. So it's just interesting how I realized that that people exist in our thoughts. Like, that's really true. That they actually just exist in my thoughts, not in my physical now reality. I'm remembering. The Course says that the body that you just either remember the body or you anticipate the body, but it's never right. The body is never in the present. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly right. I have to remember my children and my relatives and everybody that's not in my physical reality. Mm-hmm. They become a thought in my mind, but not an actual physical being in front of me. And I thought about how deep that is too. That the most important people in my present reality are always, and that's not, and I love them dearly and I know they love me, but if we were to be practicing the truth, we would realize that we, those of us who are together right now in this moment, we are the ones that are the most important to each other's enlightenment and awakening. Even though we might not understand why or how, if we are physically seeing each other, we are the most important beings to each other in this moment, mm-hmm. right now, in terms of experiencing enlightenment. Because it's right now. You know, the holy instant is now. Mm-hmm. So when I look at you and I can look at you with appreciation and not take you for granted, that's the other thing I realized mm-hmm. out of that. Mm-hmm. You know, we just take for granted mm-hmm. that I'm going to see you next
yes.
week.
Yes.
You know, that's, you have yeah. situations like that and you go, wow, that's not mm-hmm. necessarily yeah. true at all.
Right.
Totally. Yeah. You know, it's like, oh, wow, okay. Mm-hmm. So what it does for me, it makes me want to appreciate you more mm-hmm. right here, right now. Yeah. You know, and I do. Mm-hmm. And I do.
Me too.
Mm-hmm. 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 So tonight.
Thank you, Earl.
Thank you, buddy. Yeah,
thank you.
That's funny. I just thought about you. That's deep. We're going to do the decision to accept the truth that is true always on page 241, lesson 20. But you know something, it's also a trip to know one day that really will be it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? All of us got that day that it really will be the day we lay the body down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that one of these days that's going to happen.
Yeah.
You know, so I want to have the right. I want to have the right. Notice I said lay the body down. Didn't say we die. I said lay the body down, and I'd like to lay the body down in a less dramatic way. I think.
Yes.
Fire has played a big role in my life. You know, when I was 5 years old, our house burned, and I remember vividly my mother running, trying with my younger sister and I, and trying to get us out of the house when it was on fire. And then my sister and my brother-in-law made her transition through a house fire 6 years ago.
Wow.
And then, boom, here I am with a fire. So we
got
a fire. We got a fire thing going on.
Got a fire going on.
Yeah, we got a
fire.
Yeah.
You should be done with fire.
Oh, that's funny. Y'all want to hear a good joke about all of it?
Yeah.
I realized afterwards that I said, wait a minute, I put organic milk, and then I went aloe juice.
Yeah.
I said, I was trying to prepare myself. I was cooking to be cooked. I was preparing myself like I was a meal or something. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yeah, barbecue. I said, I'm trying to barbecue myself. I'm going there to put some organic juice. I said, my ego's trying to barbecue me. Okay. I'm like, okay, dude. All right.
I still want to know when you got your pants on.
Huh? They brought me some. They got me some.
Thank
they got
God
me some clothes.
Me some pants.
They got me
to
some
run
clothes.
Around in your room.
Yeah, it was a trip. It was a trip.
Well, thank you for sharing all this and witnessing how spirit really, really acts.
Yeah.
In our lives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is such a story that we can't deny it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, here's another one. There's a trip. One of my dear friends, her name is Lavish. She said she was going to go to Vegas. She had gotten a ticket to go to Vegas, and she didn't even know why she was going. Why she got the ticket? And we met for lunch. It turned out she was on the exact same. She had same flight.
Wow.
That I was on. And not only did she happen to be on the exact same flight that I was on, my boarding was 8:35 and hers was 8:34. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, just all these synchronicities. And so when I got to the airport, you know, I met her, and she was so glad to see me and everything. And so, and it was like, it was at the airport. It was really funny because it was at the airport that it hit me. Mm-hmm. It's like when everything hit me, the gratitude I felt and mm-hmm. the love mm-hmm. that I felt and how blessed I was. So I just, that's where I cried, was in the airport. Yeah. It's like I just got overwhelmed with emotion in the airport. Mm-hmm. And it just, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, this stuff we're studying is true. It's mm-hmm. real. Doesn't mean that you might not have something happen that you prefer not to happen. Yeah. But it does mean there's another way to look at it. Mm-hmm. See, that's
all
the
right.
thing.
Yeah, I remember mm-hmm. that.
Earl, I just really want to thank you for, because what I'm really hearing is just the simplicity. Mm. How simple it is. How you just recognize, oh, like with the manager, you just recognize, oh, you know, if she were different, I would be happy. And then you made that recognition, and boom, mm-hmm. there was a change. Because mm-hmm. a lot of times the ego, at least for me, what the ego does is try to make it complicated and be like, you have to go through all these rituals, and then you might get it. You have to do it perfect. And then just the simplicity of being like, oh, I recognize that, and then boom.
Yeah, I'm determined. I am determined to see. Mm-hmm. You know, I am determined to free every, as a sign of my love for everybody in my life, I want to free them from any responsibility for my happiness mm-hmm. in any kind of way. Mm-hmm. You know, I just think it's cruel what we do to each other when we're asleep. Mm-hmm. And that's when we're asleep. I mean, how much we really try to make people feel guilty for not doing something that's not their responsibility to begin with. Mm-hmm. Because I won't take the time to change my mind. You know, I want you to do it. And then the irony of it, the paradox is, the minute you started to do it, then everybody started doing the stuff you were trying to get them to do that you were mad about. Or who will do it shows up. That's the other thing I'm learning. Mm-hmm. Let go of your attachment to the form, and you can have the content anytime you want it. Exactly. You know, and so what I'm doing now too is I'm trying to let go of who's gonna love me. Mm-hmm. And just be welcome to love. Mm-hmm. And that's been deep too. Because maybe the fastest way for something to get to you isn't the way you've decided it should come. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Isn't the way you've decided. Might not be the fastest way. You know. So I want it quickly. So I figure if I just let go of my decision about who it's supposed to be and how it's supposed to be, then the universe can go ahead and do its things. And my part is to be so loving and so appreciative to the channel that it shows up in. But you know, like there was a dance that Saturday night that was unbelievable. The love, you know, at one point I was dancing with 7 women from Japan at the same time.
All right.
It was a trip. And they loved them some rods, let me tell you. They had been watching me, and it was such a trip to hear them talk and with how excited and how innocent they were and how loving mm-hmm. they were. And so I was just feeling the love from so many people. And sometimes, you know, when you're having that good vibe and you dance with somebody and the energy is good, and you can tell they're attracted to you and the energy in your mind, and go, maybe this should be something I follow up on, or you should let happen more than once, you know. Mm-hmm. And this boy said to me, would you be willing to have this experience right now and not try to do anything to repeat it? Mm-hmm. And I was like, whoa. Because if you don't try to repeat it, your ego won't get involved.
Yeah.
Because there's no need for you to try to figure out how to make this happen again. Mm-hmm. You know, it'll happen again as long as you don't try to grab this moment and hold on to it. Wow. And I was like, that's what the voice is talking to me now. So I just dropped any of my get energy. And as soon as I did that, even more people came. Even more loving women in me and showed up. And it was like, oh, okay, so if I can just not try to repeat it, and just be totally present and loving when it's happening, that's it. Mm-hmm. Don't get no better than that. Mm-hmm. Because if anything else was supposed to happen, it would. Mm-hmm. That's it. It took 35 years to get that. only. No telling how many millions of years I was asleep So in the scheme of things, the time we've been spending on enlightenment is like that. And you don't know how, remember he said a few weeks ago in the Way of Mastery that the reason why we were studying is because we tried everything and we've done everything. And that's why we're finally open to this, because we've tried every kind of physical pleasure you can imagine. We've already tried it. We've already done it. We've done. That's not saying we can't experience these things in the spirit of joy, but we know there's something more, and we want it. Because you can have the pleasures of the body. You can have power, fame, money, and physical pleasure. So why make it such a big deal? You can, if you want to have it, you can have it. If you want to do it, you can do it. So there's no need to make it the all, be all, end all anymore. Because there's no sin. You're innocent. So you can have any experience you choose to have in an innocent, loving way. What I want to do now is wake up. That's what I want to do. Because you can wake up and see some, and that's what was so cool about Vegas. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. Because I saw people who acted more spiritual than so-called spiritual people. They were having fun. They were enjoying themselves. They were not judging outfits that people wore. It was interesting watching how some of the spiritual people were so judgmental of everything that was going on around them, and they thought that was being spiritual. Like judging the scantily clad women or the people being, at the, you know, and they think because I'm spiritual, then this isn't acceptable, you know. But then they were whole, but the vast majority of people got it. And that was cool. Because that's the greatest joy anybody can give me is to be themselves around me. I don't have a way you need to be. You can be any way you want to be. You know, and that's who I like to be around. If you're my friend and I'm thinking too much, then something's wrong. If I'm having like think before I speak and think before I act and not scared that I'm offend you some kind of way, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time with you. But I wish you well. But I ain't going to go out with you. I want to have fun. I don't want to be judged. You know, this is too short for that kind of stuff. This thing is short, you all. You know. So, the way of transformation, and please check this out. The way of transformation and what? Please listen carefully. I knew it was a catch. The way of, he said go slow. That's nothing he's been saying. Go slow. It don't make any difference if it's just one sentence that you take out of this. The way of transformation, and please listen carefully, is not a process of changing the unworthiness in you to the point where finally you are knocking at heaven's door and you then awaken. Okay, I say it again. Transformation is not a process of trying to change the unworthiness in you until you get to the point you wake up. Don't you see that that's what we tend to do? We think this whole trip is us somehow or another getting rid of the sense of unworthiness, then we wake up. He says that's not it. He says rather the way of transformation rests on your decision to accept the truth that is true always, and that's what I was saying. I accept the truth that the Holy Spirit told me that the ego's rule is seek and do not find. So, excuse me, I had some smoke stuff. So he still would go, if this were different, I'd be happy. I accepted that that's not the way to be. And that's not, I'm trying to work on my unworthiness, right? I and my creator are one. Now that that is out of the way, how would a Christ, and what is a Christ? A Christ is nothing but the part of ourselves that is our true identity. So he says, how would your true self live in this dimension? How would a true self bring himself or herself to each moment of experience? What voice would Christ listen to? What vision would he or she serve? And that's what I was saying the other night, to be in that situation of all those beautiful people and not have that male drive to get. Was the way the Christ would be. Because there's nothing for me to get. What's mine can't stay away from me. what's yours is irresistible to you. You can't resist love. You can resist specialness, but you can't resist love. Right? How, think about that. There are people that you are that you would be irresistible to. They couldn't resist you. I know that's right. The struggle to awaken is the very obstacle to its accomplishment. Be with that sentence. The struggle to awaken is the very obstacle to its accomplishment, okay? Mm. The fact that you look at it as if you are struggling to wake up, that is what's blocking you waking up. The whole idea that it is a struggle. That is why the 5 minutes as Christ, your true self, was given to you as a very simple exercise. And if indeed you desire Christ, that means your true self, above what?
All things.
Would you not participate in it each day? Mm-hmm. For that which you desire and love is that which pulls your attention to it. If you love Christ, the self we all share, then let Christ, the self we all share, your true identity, pull you. That means attract you to spending 5 minutes a day in the realization that you can only be what you are created to be. So it's not like we have to seek it. This, we're being told it's going to pull us to it. That's different. Me going after you is different from you grabbing my hand and pulling me to you. That's what happened. I was standing up there, and this woman came from out of nowhere, and she just grabbed me and started dancing with me. You know, she pulled me to her. Mm. You know, it was a great dance too. Let me tell you.
Don't repeat it.
Yeah, and that was, and it's obvious I'm not going to repeat it because we don't now we know where she is now. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because I didn't try to get a phone number or whatever. Mm-hmm. There was no need to try to repeat that experience because that's insinuating that there won't be others. So I don't have to grab, you know. But you really appreciate each moment. So don't take that to mean that you don't really, really, really appreciate that person, but you do. Ask it is the people that I try to grab and get that I give the hardest time. Mm-hmm. Having accepted that as the truth, then inquire into your own Christ mind on how you will live this day. For the mind that is awakened sees no distinction anymore between being here and not being here. What does that mean? You can always go, what does that mean? Okay, the mind that is awakened sees no distinction between heaven and earth. What does that mean? The mind that is awakened sees no distinction between eternity and time. Don't you see that's true? If you've been in the present moment and you're not trying to get and you're receiving and you're doing that in every moment, that is eternity. It sees no distinction between the non-material and material or physicality. That's what I was saying. It wasn't like being in Las Vegas, somehow or another, God wasn't there and spirit wasn't there. It's if Las Vegas is separated all from the rest of the, you know, what's holy. Mm. Right? I mean, you have to feel innocent at some level to dress the way some of these people were dressing that I saw that night. You know, you can't have a lot of self-consciousness about your body when you got it is revealed as I saw. I'm not talking about the dancers. I'm just talking about the people walking down the street.
Yeah.
I never saw people looking like that just walking down the street before. You know, and it felt good to be around people who thought they were beautiful or who thought they were attractive because you're so used to seeing people who are self-conscious about their bodies or don't feel comfortable about their appearance. And that was not the case with a lot of people that I saw that night. And it was obviously not the case about material prosperity. You know, because it was the illusion at its finest. You know. And we were right in the middle of it talking about the course. It was so cool. Mm-hmm. That was great. The mind that is awakened sees no distinction between the extraordinary and the ordinary. Okay, any thoughts? Anybody want to share any questions, any comments?
Now, those times when the illumination is just coming through, everything glows.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's just full.
Everything. Just think, if you're having this comes from you and doesn't come from anywhere else, then there's nowhere you couldn't be happy. That's what I'm saying. Even an extreme example of, if the fire had not happened, then you would be happy. I was like, whoa. Mm. If you didn't have to move, you would be happy. Because those were feelings anytime I was feeling upset about, that was exactly what I was saying. Mm-hmm. I was saying, if this had not happened, then I would be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So I still was practicing the ego's thought system, even if I said I wish the fire had not happened.
Mm-hmm.
Deep. Let all things be exactly as they are. Because of that, even though I got a lot of stuff to deal with at the material level, the difference it made in my awakening was worth the price of admission.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
And I found out I wasn't as attached to my possessions as I thought I was.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I still managed somehow to have a lot. I can hoard very good. It's amazing when you try to go through stuff and you're trying to like sort stuff out because you got everything, and then you'll see like, oh, here's a ticket stub from a 1984 movie. I think I need to keep that.
Yeah.
You know. And y'all know what I'm talking about. You go through stuff, and you're like, stuff you haven't even looked at in months and months, and you'll be going through stuff in years, and you'll find a reason to want to do it. So I found myself throwing away things that I have valued the most.
Yeah.
Wow.
And instead of feeling the way I thought I was going to feel, I felt freer, even though I still got a ton of stuff to do.
Wow.
But still, for me, that was big.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That was big. I threw away electronics.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
just keep it to yourself.
Just saying.
I'm just saying. I threw away cameras.
Oh, wow.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Anybody know me knows that's big.
Mm-hmm.
That's big.
Well, I think it's so powerful, too, just the whole facing that and dealing with it. There's something profound about doing it in the nude. You were completely naked.
Yeah.
I told the people at the conference about it. It was a trip.
It's like
I had thought about that. That was pretty big.
It's
naked. Facing it naked.
That's like
you go into the fire naked and you're into the transformation.
Great point. I had thought about it, but I really hadn't thought about it until you said that. That was like being naked.
You know,
right.
Just
stripped
down, just you.
Yeah.
Where,
right.
How you came into the world.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Nothing.
That's
no
right.
possessions.
That's right.
No.
Yeah.
Nothing. You know. And that's the whole thing with fire is just really a major sign of rebirth.
Well,
so for you
YouTube.
To say I feel reborn. Mm-hmm.
It was on YouTube.
What?
Crazy.
You hit real fire.
Really?
Thank you.
I don't think it was. I didn't think so. But. Thank you. But thank you for saying that, though.
Yeah, that's
because I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was deep.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. But just think about it. That's like your worst nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
When you really think about it for a second, you know, it's like not only fire, but naked.
Yeah.
You know, but then on the other hand, a fire, naked.
Yeah.
But how powerful, too, that didn't stop you from trying to put the fire out.
Yeah,
it's
really.
Like you were thinking, like, oh, I can't go out on my balcony, you know. It's like, no, I got milk. Olive oil.
That's right. I don't have had it when I got some salt and pepper. I know something would have been on it. Like, they did this.
Yes.
You save that olive oil for later.
Well, it's really interesting that you went to something made you go to the refrigerator.
Yeah.
It's like,
isn't it?
You know, instead of, you know, a pitcher in the water.
Yeah.
It's like, go to the fridge.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just the whole thing.
I wanted it to stop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that was the thing. Because if you're doing something like that, you're present dealing with it, but at the same time, you're projecting it into the future in terms of how bad it can be.
Right.
Mm-hmm. At the exact same time, you out of the moment. You're out of the moment. Had to get present. Y'all are awesome. Thank you for saying that. Wow, I was naked.
Mm-hmm. Actually, being naked was a safer thing for you, too, because your clothes couldn't catch on fire.
Right.
Yeah.
The heat would drive your body away, but your clothes couldn't catch on fire. Mm-hmm. You couldn't be trapped in clothes. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Wow. All right. Mm-hmm. Anybody else before I go further? Y'all look especially fine tonight. I don't know why, but y'all look really juicy. I tell you, it's like more juicy than usual.
All right.
You got those glasses.
Yeah, that's right. It's the glasses.
I just feel like pouring some aloe gel on all of
y'all. That's right.
No, that would have put this fire out.
Absolutely.
Thank you for sharing. Spoken like a true Leo.
That's right.
Now tell me, she doesn't look like a feline. She does, doesn't she?
Yeah.
It's what's so strange about astrology. I mean, people really can look like their signs. Like the Leo is the lion or the feline, you know. We'll go on further. I can't believe it's time is moving fast. Mm-hmm. Having accepted that as the truth, then inquire into your own Christ mind on how you will live this day. Okay, I did that. But rather, reality is returned to the mind, and reality, how do you pronounce it?
Suffuses
what the mind experiences. Mm-hmm. And the literal world that you thought you used to know, that's right, buildings, cars, governments, and all the rest, simply becomes what? A temporary harmless illusion that seems to have hoodwinked your brothers and sisters. And that's what it feels like now. I feel like my brothers and sisters are hoodwinked. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like they really do believe in what the world has taught them. Mm-hmm. And they're hoodwinked. Right? Because the world is now seen in its transparency, it is no longer fearful to you. That means you are free to walk and abide in the world as long as the body lasts. But how? Quietly, joyfully, going about your most extraordinary, ordinary task. Except they have become translated into the means whereby you demonstrate the truth of love to the world. Mm-hmm. So that was an extraordinary, ordinary experience, right? Mm-hmm. But it was translated into what? The means whereby I'm demonstrating the truth of love to the world. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what just happened.
Right.
Reactivity, suffering, doubt, depression, in other words, dis-ease, can only be the reflection of a decision to use the power of the mind to desire and therefore to perceive and experience what is unlike the truth. Okay, so we were just told that when you go through reactivity, suffering, doubt, and depression, when a person goes through suffering, doubt, and depression, there is a reflection of a decision to use the power of their mind unlike the truth. So there are people who are using the power of their mind to demonstrate everything that's not like love, just as there are people who are using the power of their mind to demonstrate what is like love. So everybody in the world, they're using their power completely, but some people are using their power to demonstrate everything that's not truth, but it's still their choice. So that's why you let them be. That's why you bless them, because they could make another choice, but they don't. Woo! I love this stuff. Freedom, peace, unlimitedness, and above all, fearlessness must necessarily be what? The result of the decision to use the power of the mind to remember, to realize, to abide in, and to extend the truth that is true always. Okay, so guess what? We just heard how to have freedom, truth, and unlimitedness, and fearlessness. How do we do it? You make the decision to use your mind to remember. See, people come together for at truth classes to analyze. And he's saying, no, freedom comes from coming together to remember. To remember, to realize, and to abide in, and to extend the truth. Because when we come together, we can talk as weird as we want. So when we don't take advantage of the opportunity to talk weird to each other, talk this truth to each other, we're missing a beautiful opportunity, because in most cases, you can't do that with ordinary people. So we have an opportunity to freely share the truth with each other without worrying about how weird we seem. That's a blessing. That's a huge blessing. Then the passing phenomenon called life, I like that, the passing phenomenon called life is simply seen as a delightful dance. And that was, and it was a Rolling Stones cover band. And they was like off the chain. I never really paid attention to the Rolling Stones. I never really heard the Rolling Stones music. And because when I grew up, there wasn't the music that was played around me. But this band made me want to listen to the Rolling Stones because the music was so raw and alive, you know. And then notice he said, it's simply seen as a delightful dance. It has no purpose in and of itself. Once you gave it a purpose unlike God's, but as Christ, which is your true self, the purpose that you see in the world is shared by your Creator with you. What does that mean? It means your will has become the same as God's. What does that mean? It means you want to abide and be of service in the process whereby those that have been hoodwinked can remember the truth and become free. So you are going to be used to free those who've been hoodwinked. And the way you're going to do it is to be given freedom, peace, and unlimitedness and fearlessness. And you're going to dance. It no longer matters how that occurs. That's right. I don't care how it occurs anymore. He says, that is what form your teaching occurs in. It's all the same. You see no difference between your form and somebody else's, for you recognize, you will recognize the teachers of God. When you are in any moment, where you are in any moment becomes a divine gift, literally dropped in your lap as an opportunity to do what? Check it out. To enjoy what? The remembrance that you are one with God. So this class is an opportunity for us to enjoy remembering that we're one with God. And it is a joy for me to remember I'm one with God with you. We are actually experiencing it. Even though I know you think it would be a lot more enjoyable with that special someone. But you can have it that way too. See, that's what's so cool about it. You can have it any way you want it. You know, you can have it with that special someone. That's cool. You can have it any way you want to because you're innocent. And you're sinless and you're loved. Then why hasn't it happened? Because you're still saying that this were different, you'd be happy. What do you mean? That means you need to start loving exactly what's happening, exactly the way it is right now. That's what it means. I mean, it's kind of personally insulting to you all if I was sitting up here thinking I would have a much better time without you. You know what I'm saying? Like if I'm sitting up here right now going, oh my God, if I was just with somebody else besides you all right now, I would be so happy. You know, and that's really what we're saying when we're around each other and we don't have appreciation for each other. We're actually saying, you're not good enough. I need somebody else who would be much more pleasing to me than you. Right? So, you're innocent, but it's almost like a form of dishonoring for me to be here with you all wishing I was with somebody else. instead of realizing that we could have this delightful dance of remembering that we're one with God together right now. And whatever I want to experience, even at a physical level, Spirit has sent the person to me that I can do that with, and you too. Mm-hmm. Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. But if you realize your happiness comes from you, ultimately it won't matter. Because if my happiness is coming from my thoughts about you, then I can just think about you and feel wonderful, whether I'm in your presence or not. Do you do that sometimes? I think about you all when you're not around and I feel good. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's not really necessary to have physical contact in order to experience pleasure. Mm-hmm. Even though it's my favorite way. Because I'm hoodwinked. this is great. Oh, God. I was having such a different experience last Tuesday. Goodness gracious, I was having such a... Wow. Anyway, where you are, an opportunity to remember that everything you are seeing is, what is this? It's an opportunity to remember that everything you are seeing is a passing illusion. It's an opportunity to remember that everything you're seeing is a passing illusion in the sense that it used to have a purpose that seemed concrete. And that purpose, that concrete purpose, has dissolved and gone. Where did the world go? I used to think it was a fearful place. I used to think that I had to get ahead. I used to think that there were those who could victimize me. Now I just see harmlessness. I see nothing out there that can add anything to me. That's just what we were saying earlier, isn't it? That when you start to wake up, the reason why the world seems harmless to you is that you no longer see yourself as missing anything. So, see, nobody can hurt me if I'm whole, because I would never allow myself to feel bad about whatever you did. So you couldn't hurt me because I don't need your validation. So you couldn't hurt me. You can only hurt me when I need your validation, when I need something for you to give me something to make me feel whole. So I'm not afraid to be loving to people, because less and less am I trying to get anything from them. And so since I'm not trying to get anything from them, then I'm not worried about what they're trying to get from me either. So I can go ahead and love you. I love that. Wow. Wow. So if you won't love people because you're afraid to be hurt, it probably means you're the one that's trying to get. And you feel like they may not give you what you want. Mm-hmm. So you contract. It's so much fun reminding people that they're cool. Oh my God. Anyway. I am simply at rest and at peace, delighting at play in my Creator's kingdom. And where I am, what is Christ? What is Christ? Your true self, your loving self abides. So the distance from where you may yet perceive yourself to be, the distance from where you may yet perceive yourself to be, and where you may perceive us to be, is only the distance of a decision. So we're only as far from loving people as a decision. And I made the decision, even though my ego don't think I deserve it. That's why I'm going to witness to you that you do.
Yeah.
And if you really want to believe it, we'll be drawn to each other. Mm-hmm. If you don't really want to believe it, you're not going to move toward those who witness to you that you're loving. That decision waits upon what? Your welcome, not time. Mm. So, no one can take from you the power to decide to own your own identity as God's child. I am going to own my decision to own my decision to, I'm going to decide, I decide to own the fact that I am a child of love. I've decided to own my identity. I am the Holy Son of God himself. I am as God created me. It doesn't matter if I believe it or not. It doesn't matter if I believe. I could hate myself all day and all night, and I could criticize myself all day and all night, and it wouldn't change that one whit. So lighten up. Lighten up. Because I don't care how hard you are on yourself, it doesn't have any effect on you. Mm-hmm. So lighten up. So let's acknowledge us for hearing this much tonight. Wow. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Let's do the financial expression of appreciation. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that we have, all that we give, and all that we receive. We are sustained by the love of God. That means we are sustained by God's love for us, not our love for God. Those of you who are online and you like to make a financial expression of appreciation, you can go to my website, EarlPurdy.com, and I'm also available for, I haven't done any clarity sessions since this experience, so I'm kind of curious to see what the next one is going to be like.
It's going to be hot.
Well, they've been extraordinary. It's going to be profound.
Hot.
Yeah, it's going to be really hot. Yeah, it's going to be really hot. Steamy. That's what I'm going to advertise. Would you like to have a steamy clarity session?
Well, yes, I would.
Thank you for sharing. I really, really appreciate you all sharing. God, everything that we have comes only from God. Everything that you have comes only from God. Everything you have comes only from God. But be grateful for the channels. And I'm grateful for you so much. But it's just beginning, you all. It's just beginning. Whatever this transformation is, this is going to be a long, hot summer.
Yeah, I know, right?
Oh, they're playing my song. I got a new song now. Every time I hear the sirens, it's like, oh, they're playing my song. Oh, oh God. I was thinking about those guys, you know. We need to take our hat off to those guys.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, that they're willing, that's what
just
they choose to do.
Run into a burning building. Yeah.
They
yeah.
choose to run into burning buildings.
Yeah.
You know, think about that. That's a trip. That's a yeah. trip. It's isn't it amazing what the different parts of you do?
Yeah.
You know, that's us. All of them are us. We are us. We are us. We are us. We
wow.
are us. And when you look around this room, you are literally looking at yourself.
Mm.
That's not a metaphor. That's a fact. But we're hoodwinked, so we forget. They're coming for me. They're looking for me. Well, that's my spiritual name, Crackling.
Crackling, yeah.
Oh, I'm so glad I can laugh.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm so glad I can laugh.
Mm-hmm.
Have you gone through any kind of challenging experience that you now look back on?
Wow.
And
yeah.
Man,
oh, yeah.
But at the time, it was anything
not
but fun.
Very fun.
So we just need to laugh sooner.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, anybody want to share anything before we close? Yeah, Chris?
Well, I do want to share something.
Mm-hmm.
When you were talking about how we use the power... we use the power to either, you know, be in suffering. We use the power that's been given us to either be in suffering or enjoy.
Yeah.
It really resonated with me because there's a part in the course where he says that we send out either messengers of love,
that's right,
or messengers of fear.
That's right.
And so the messengers of love come back and like bring us like everything of love that they like. And the messengers of fear come back and bring us everything of fear that they like.
That's right. A perception is a messenger.
Wow.
That's another term for perception is messenger.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I love knowing I can decide how I want to see you. I can decide how I want to see you. Mm-hmm. And I can decide to see you in a way that brings, that thrills me. Especially if all I want from you is the truth, and for you to be used as a means for me to receive the truth, I could never be disappointed with any interaction I have with you. If I want to use everybody in this room for the truth, there's no way you can stop me. If I want to use you for a fantasy, that may or may not happen. But if I want to use you all for the truth, I'm going to be successful every time.
Mm.
So if you want to have guaranteed success in your interactions with anybody, make truth the goal.
Mm-hmm.
And you are guaranteed to have an incredible time. Because even if they're not into the truth, the Holy Spirit will still show you how to use everything about that interaction
for the truth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they don't even have to know the truth themselves, which is great.
Yeah.
I think we're in a no-lose curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we finally chosen something that you can't lose in.
That's why
I
keep doing it.
Okay, so let me close on this phrase. You and your Creator are one. Now that that's out of the way, how would you and your true self live in this dimension? How would you and your true self bring yourself to each moment of experience? What voice would your true self listen to? What vision would your true self serve? Thank you, Mighty Companions. Bless you, beautiful. I don't know where none of my stuff is. That's why I didn't have my music and everything else tonight. I don't, you know how it is when you got stuff everywhere. You know, this is like, you know, and so, but tomorrow I get maybe get a chance to locate everything.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know, if that were different, we would have had a better class.
It's an amazing class. Yeah, I didn't even notice
well,
no music.
Are amazing.
I didn't either.
Yourself.
You're taking pot.
Whole
new level.
That's great. That's right. Oh yeah, what happened, it's funny, I was talking about being naked, right?
Mm-hmm.
At the end of at the finale of the conference, they threw me a pair of underwear.
All right. Perfect.
Yeah, it was like from the stage. It said, Earl, we heard you needed some underwear, and they threw me a pair of underwear in the finale of the conference. It's funny. I said, whoever would have thought,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's what my life would come to.
Exactly.
Especially
in Vegas.
Wasn't that appropriate in Vegas?
Right, exactly.
Yes, right. That's
too much
right.
Clothing in Vegas.
But never underestimate the power of underwear.
Yeah.